will apologize at the outset for the last time. We don't have much of a program set up, and that's my fault. I just got back from out of town. I'm a little bit grubby, and everybody's here at 7 o'clock, so I'm just going to go ahead anyways. Hope to get an actual lesson plan together after this. Again, the videos we started recording were never really meant to be like things that went online that we're supposed to teach everybody how to save the world. They were more just our own little teaching things we're going to put online, but now actually there seems to be so much more interest online that we should probably just put a whole, you know, a lesson plan together and start covering topics that have titles and research it and just, you know, oh, I want to learn about driving no license, so, you know, let's click on that video or whatever. So we're going to start getting into that for the next video better. I've just been informed that we've been getting emails from, I don't know, as far away as Australia, for people asking for clarification on things. I will address a few of those real quick here before we get into some things. I just quickly went over them right before class. And I wanted to address one here because, the fan was kind of noisy. There's one thing I love to do when I get thrown in jail for the weekend or for 4 or 5 days, and I love to teach people their rights in prison. And who is there more of in prison than anybody else in Canada?
Natives.
Indians. Right? So I'll do a quick little thing on this. The first thing I like to teach people, as soon as I get out of my cell for the first time, we all sit around the tables, I grab one of those requisition forms for the canteen, I grab a pencil, and just say, okay, who wants to learn their rights? And five, six guys will gather around right away, and they say, oh, okay, let's see what this guy has to say. Because they're in jail, we got nothing else to do. So, because somebody has a question here about, apparently one of my videos I said anything that has a signature is bad. I don't remember saying that. It's probably taken out of context.
Anything that has a government signature is bad.
Actually, anything that's got a government signature is good.
Or your signature on a government document.
Yes.
Exactly.
Because you want to make sure you know what you're signing.
Right.
Right? Because that's your liability going on that document now. So it could be bad. It could also be very good.
Okay. Over in the meeting room.
But, okay, so what was I going to say? So the person has a question about the citizenship provided by the government, has a signature, blah, 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 and he goes on to say something about for a native of Canada. Okay, there was a guy in the Winnipeg Sun 2 months ago, a native guy went to court and basically fired his lawyer when they called his white man name in the court. He said, that's not my name. And then they said, well, what is your name? And he spoke his name in his own language. And they said, well, how do you spell that? And, you know, he's being a little belligerent and said something like, you know, it's not a written language yet. You know, you're an idiot kind of thing, right? And got into it with them. And then he said, Canadian law doesn't apply to me. And he said, I'm an Aboriginal. Your laws don't apply to me, okay? Fatal mistake made in writing that word. That's the first thing I like to teach Native people. So I'm going to actually, I want to put that on here because... I'm sorry, I've spent lots of time with them now in the jails, and I'm going to tell you, 90% of them don't deserve to be there. I'm an Aboriginal. No. Okay, let's play some word games. Let's use the word un... Nope. Unclean. And abnormal. Those are really the only three words you need to explain what's going on here, okay? Because you people were given the same education as we were, public education, courtesy of the government, that taught us to be as completely incompetent as we could possibly be to be reliant on the government. So they got you to call yourself the wrong thing right off the hop. If you're an Aboriginal, that's the same as calling yourself... You can either be, anyways, if you don't know much about the English language, that's called a prefix. And a prefix can completely change the word following the prefix.
So, negative.
There you go. So it can change it to be good or bad. And I'm guessing it's bad because you can either be abnormal or normal. You can be unclean or you can be clean. You can be an aboriginal or you can be the original people of this land. And the original people of this land are men and women. That's actually all of us. We're all the inhabitants of this land because we're all born here. We're all of this soil. We're all of this earth. That's all of us. So men and women, the man, is the original people of this land. If you're calling yourself this, That's a status with the government. I'm a status Indian. I'm an Aboriginal. Well, there's liabilities attached to that. And that's why you're in jail. Right? Deal with the government, and you're going to get the short end of the stick. So just be prepared. And people might want to do their own research on exactly what that all entails, being an Aboriginal as opposed to the original people of this land. So hopefully that helps them with whatever they're asking for about citizenship and whatnot. Because what is citizenship? It's the citizenship.
Wardship.
Citizenship. You're on the citizenship. You're on Canada.
It's Canada.
Yeah. Well, congratulations. Enjoy all that comes with that. So, there was that one. There's one I liked here, actually. Basically said something about, okay, so how is this? I'm making claim to the legal person, John Doe, all capital letters, name. Well, you don't make a legal claim to it. You know, you got the birth certificate. That's your claim to it. You don't need to proactively make more of a legal claim to something you've already got proof of owning all the equity in already. I will hereafter be known as, you can call yourself anything, man. My friends have some names for me that I wouldn't really like to put on camera. You know, my dad calls me son. Call yourself whatever you want to be called at, but don't be afraid to just call yourself by the, you know, the upper lowercase version of your own name. Never be afraid of that, but differentiate it. If you're in police custody and they ask you for your name, never give it verbally, ever. Ask for a piece of paper and write it down, or spell it out and say capital D, lowercase e, lowercase a, lowercase n, and then spell out your last name the same way. So there's no misunderstandings, because you could be saying anything when you just say it out loud verbally, right? So anyways, whereas I understand that I am the director, administrator, president, CEO, king, and chief of said legal person. Right. Make up whatever title you want, as long as it sounds very very authoritative, right? Wonderful. Whatever you want to be, as long as you've made it clear it's a position of authority in that organization. Therefore, I ask that all affected parties send me proof of claim of anything they allege I cannot do. That'd be a spin-off what we talked about with the Newey Corps there last week, where I send them a 50-page document of your right to wash your underwear first thing in the morning before you leave for work, right? You send them something saying, hey, even though I don't think you guys are really telling me I don't have human rights, I just want to clarify, is there something you're claiming I can't do? Right? That's a good initial contact with the government. Starts your business relationship that ended when you got your birth certificate. You never contact them ever again. Well, you may want to do that. Set some terms up and get a business relationship going with these people, right? Also, the reason I like that is how hard would it be to ask a simple variation of that to a Crown before you go to summary convictions court? Therefore, I ask that all affected parties send me proof of a claim of an injury. Send that to a Crown before court. When he doesn't respond, get a certificate of default printed up and file that into the court record before court. Right? You're given an opportunity to deal with these things administratively and ask really good questions like that before court. Because once you're in court in summary convictions, you're the defendant. Okay? They're the plaintiff, you're the defendant. If you're there, it's because you haven't settled. You haven't contacted them. Why haven't you contacted them? Well, you're not even attempting to contact and settle this dispute, so I'm going to settle it for you, is what's going on. Even though we all know what's really going on in the court anyways, is they are assuming you're a public servant. So address that as well, right? Another good question to ask the cops on the side of the road, by the way.
The layers of the onion.
Yeah. Again, presumptions. I keep telling everybody with that explanation of when we're all going out for dinner. I like to keep hammering that one through. We're all going out for dinner, and no one is asked who's paying the bill. Right, so just keep that in mind. Every time you're dealing with government, any time they speak to you, they make you an offer, they contact you, you want to get all the presumptions out of the way so there's nothing left to interpretation later. Because they'll interpret anything they want. Interpret. Sorry, not interpret. I don't think that's a word. Anyways. Okay, so a lot of people have asked about driving. Everybody wants to get rid of their licenses and drive without a license plate, which is a great idea if you're willing and able to make the arguments at the side of the road, you're willing to get arrested and be beaten and thrown in jail, if you're willing to have your car towing at least once and throwing the impound and never get it back ever. That's happened to me twice now. Don't do it unless you're sure that you're, you know, in your convictions, you want to start the free man process, and, you know, because they're going to start testing us all a lot more in the next little while here, because more and more of us are waking up every day and starting to drive around with our own plates and question authority, and oh boy, slave masters don't like it when, you know, the slaves get uppity. So they'll start to beat us a little bit harder before they let any of us really start to get away. So let's go over driving.
Anyway. I got a suggestion.
Yeah.
Lease the vehicles.
No. Don't ever do that.
No?
No.
What about under
your... Who owns the equity in the leased vehicle?
Well...
Not you.
No, you see, the thing is, if they take it, it's not yours anyway.
But that's not really honorable.
So what?
yeah, I don't like that. This is an honor system, right? Plus, if you don't own the equity, you can't control the vehicle. Plus, you're going to do that maybe once until your credit's destroyed, and then you're out of the vehicle, period.
You know what? Farm equipment doesn't need a license.
Yeah, okay, good point. So you can drive a lawn tractor around, yeah. No. And the other part I like about this as well is that when you're buying a cheap car, because you've got to buy it cash now, right? That's great with my whole divestment idea from the government, period, right? Because now you're not buying a $50,000 car on credit. No interest payments. You're not paying $3,500 in GST alone on that vehicle anymore, which is just straight to the government profits, right? To feed their bloated organization, where they're just going to have more money to hire more cops to beat more of us at the side of the road. So now you're buying a cheap car, you're not paying taxes on it because you're not registering it. So they lose out on that revenue, which they should, because this is private. This is all in the private. We're keeping everything that we do more into the private realm and keeping it out of the public realm, which we know public license plate, a public servant driver's license. Government, to get jurisdiction, has to get you to apply for all these things in the public. Public insurance, public this, public that. It's all bad. Insurance is a scam anyways. It's impossible. We just spoke about that before class today. It's impossible for somebody else to assume liability for your actions. It's impossible. That's an insurance scam. Anybody who shows up with a suit and tie and says, hey, just sign here and we'll pay for any kind of damages you cause when you're out and about. Right? It's impossible. It's a scam. Like I said, I can't pay anybody here money to go punch somebody else in the face and say, don't worry about it, I'll assume liability for you punching them in the face. No! It doesn't happen. Believe me, the guy that does the punching is still going to jail. I'll be going as an accessory though.
Because he took money to punch someone in the face.
Yeah. Right? I'll just be alongside with you. We'll be cellmates, and there we can discuss the insurance policy that we thought we had in place, right? So that's a big farce. Don't ever fall for that. Okay, so driving. Driving without a license. It's really simple. You get in your car and you drive around. I know. Shockingly difficult, isn't it? So the problems start when you get pulled over. Let's start with just the word driving, period. Everybody's always making arguments in court. I wasn't driving, I was traveling in my horse-drawn carriage, and I'm, you know, this and blah, 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 and they're making all these arguments about the definition of that word doesn't mean this, and they're getting into the word definition game. I hate that game. I hate that game. I never play. I just, yeah, I'm driving. So what? You know, look up the word in Black's Law Dictionary to tell you, yeah, I'm driving, I'm operating a vehicle, whatever they want. I don't care. I don't care. Because when there's no plate and there's no driver's license, I'm doing in the private. So it doesn't matter. Call it whatever word you want. I don't, if they have a different definition in their own statute, great, good for them. How does that apply to me? Where in that statute does it say, if Dean is driving, he must obey all the rules and regulations under the Highway Traffic Act? Okay? No, it doesn't say that. That's ridiculous to even think that it would. So they're making the public servant argument, and I've shown some of you guys some of the AutoPack forms from Manitoba where it says right in the fine print that you're confessing that that vehicle is being used to perform a public service if the plate's on it. So it's all trickery. They're trying to, again, a lot of, you have to realize this. None of this would really stand up to scrutiny in the real world, but they know they're never going to be in the real world against us. They know we don't know what to do. Most of us can't even defend ourselves in summary convictions, let alone then go on the offensive and go after these people and put them in their place, right? So they're really pretty not worried at all about all the deceptive, you know, wording they're using in these non-contracts. So driving. The first clue something is wrong is when they charge you under the Highway Traffic Act. You're always charged under the Highway Traffic Act. If you've been driving with some kind of an offense, so under the Highway Traffic Act, HTA, you know, section this, the whole nine yards. Okay, first problem with this is the title. Traffic. What is traffic? And is that you? Traffic, by definition, is commerce. That's it. It means commerce exclusively. Business, commerce. And what's the only commerce and business the government has any jurisdiction over? Anything performing a function of government, which is why they're trying to have your insurance papers prove that you confess that you're performing a public service on the roads. Really, well, that's news to me. Okay, that's the first problem, traffic. We almost don't even need to go any further into that about why the Highway Traffic Act doesn't apply to you. Because if you're not involved in commerce, and you're certainly not involved in commerce as an agent of the government, then it doesn't apply to you. Even if you produce a driver's license, were you performing a function of government at that moment? No. I have a license so I can. If I want to perform a service of government, I have a license to go do it. I can conduct business as an agent of the government and make money using the public roads that we own. Because you've got to remember that the government using our roads is a privilege we extend to them. And that's why they need a license to be on it to do their business. Not the other way around. It's flipped 180 degrees. Who pays for the roads? We do. They're called public roads. The gasoline taxes pay for them. They're paid for from our pocket. And they're ours. So whose permission do we need to be on them?
Ours.
Not them, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, exactly.
So actually, I have a friend I know that lives in a country on the other side of the world, actually, and I can't do the accent, so I won't. He made that argument in court a number of years back, and I was crying, I was laughing so hard, and he's telling me the story. Because he walked into court, and he basically said, well, you know, are they not the public roads in the general? Well, of course they're the public roads. He said, well, I'm the public. He said, so why do I need your permission to be on them? And the judge's like, well, and so he turned around, one of his buddies in the audience, and he said, hey, do I need permission? Hey, is that all right if I'm on the roads? He's like, oh, that's all right with me. Okay, there you have it. You know? And dismissed! Judge didn't want anything to do with that. Right? That's how simple the argument was. So, that destroys the Highway Traffic Act. That was real simple. How many people have spent years reading that, trying to find a little fine print where they make the argument, no, see here where it says driving? No, if your definition is a little bit different than the one of Black's Law Dictionary, and that means that I don't have to abide by it. It's nonsense. It's the name game. It's the same thing as walking into court and saying, I'm not that name. No one said you were that name. So, there's one of your arguments. So, traffic, I have a traffic doc, that's my first point. Gone. See, I told you we were going to get more organized around here. Okay, how can I prove that government only has jurisdiction against business or anyone conducting business as an agent of the government? Right, I think I've talked about that before. I've never actually given anybody any clues as to why that's the case. They've got this wonderful little thing called the Interpretation Act of Canada. You guys read the Interpretation Act? It's where they redefine all the words used in their acts. Right? Where pink is gray and blue is purple and, you know, you're an agent of the government, that's where all that stuff is redefined. The definitions of the words used in their acts. So that's usually the best place to find evidence, even though we don't really need it. But if you look in the Interpretation Act, and I believe it's if you look up the definition of the word business, it goes into a big, long explanation, you know, anyone performing construction, this, that, da, 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 and at the very end it says, when performing a function of government. That's great. When am I performing a function of government? That's the only business that the government has jurisdiction over, is business that's theirs, their business. Doesn't that make sense?
Yeah.
My business is my business, and their business is their business, and it says so in their own law books. So they have to get you to do their business to get jurisdiction over you. And a license does that. But it doesn't. We talked about that last time because you might have a license, but, well, I'm sorry, I'm not on duty. I don't have an existing contract where the government's been paying me to transport goods on the roads. But claiming that there is one, I'd like to see it. And where's the wrong place to make that argument? In court, after you did nothing for 6 weeks except show up and get pissed off at the judge. Okay. You're appeared gone now. Performing a function of government, point three, you applied for it. The document's got your signature on the driver's license. You even did a little competency test. You went out. Yeah, okay, you can turn left 3 times. Here's your license. Go to town. Right? So now government is assuming liability for damages you might cause when you're performing a function of government. That means you have to abide by their rules because they got underwriters, right? Well, if you're going to be acting as an agent for us when you're using the roads, we want to make sure you're being a little safe out there because if you cause damages, we got to pay for all that. So you got to abide by all these highway traffic act regulations. Okay? And you apply for it. Point three gone. Okay. So who is the government agent? You know what? I'm going to skip that one for now. Because I want to draw the triangle again. Something's going to click for you guys. So how to start driving and potentially be unmolested by agencies of government. Give notice. Give notice. Give notice. Give notice. Give notice to the agency of government that's most likely to be responsible for whatever should befall you when you get on the highways and one of their agents accosts you. Good place to start is the Attorney General, right? They love me.
Should you put the notice on your vehicle? Could you just...
Absolutely, but that's not a good place to start. Okay. You don't want to give notice when you're at the side of the road and you've been pulled over. That's like giving notice when you show up in court. Mm-hmm. Because that's what it is when you're pulled over at the side of the road. The minute they initiate contact, you're now holding court. That is administrative process.
Okay.
Okay? The plate that I use, and I think I've shown it before, and I'll grab it here again in a second, is evidence of a fee schedule is in place. That's where I want them to know who that is in that car, that truck, that vehicle, driving. I'll use all their words. I'm driving a vehicle on the roads. There's no jurisdiction there. So you contact the government in advance, right? You say, hey, I'm going to be accessing the public roads, which is my right. If you're claiming I don't have the right to access the public roads without permission from you, I'm going to give you 10 days to provide me with some evidence and facts that I don't have that right. Right? You won't hear back, especially if you send it registered mail. So you default them. And included in that notice, you might want to put a fee schedule in there. It says, by the way, in the event you don't respond, which you're not going to, I'm going to put this fee schedule in here, and I'm going to put a fee on everything that you do to me when your agents harass me on the road. So that now, I haven't had a chance to do this yet, but I've got an invoice book I carry around with me now. And I've been waiting to give up my first invoice the same way they invoice us, right? We need to get the 3-copy ones from like Staples where, oh, they pulled me over. Okay, well, 5 minutes, that's the first $1 million. So by the time he gets to the window, you could already have your first ticket written out and handed to him. Why not? That's what they do to us, isn't it?
Yeah, not the original, though.
I think the original,
yeah,
I don't care.
The yellow gum.
Yeah, exactly. That's only their nonsense.
Think of this, think of the license plate or the plates, whatever you put on it, as...
It's my flag.
Exactly. Like an American
law. It's my flag on my vessel. It's private property.
Exactly whose law is supreme on that vessel.
Yeah, and that's mine. I'm sovereign in my own property. In fact, for the time being, I'm existing in that property, which is mine. Hand him a copy of the Petty Trespass Act. You're trespassing on my property the minute you touch it. When I'm not in a car and I'm walking around the sidewalk, this is my property. That's trespass to the body. Right? Trespass to private property. Private property is your car. How do they know that? Well, mine says private property right on the plate. I mean, for the identification numbers of my fee schedule. So anyways, where did I get those numbers from? I made them up. We do that. Man creates things. We just create things. Just make it up. I'm just making shit up right now in my brain. It's great. So you send notice along with the fee schedule, right? And give them time to reply. Contact the Department of Transportation, the DOT. Contact them. Some people I know have actually gotten DOT plates. They've just made an application with the DOT. They got a DOT plate. I don't know anything about that. I don't like that idea. I don't like putting anything in there on my property. Yeah. Period. Just again for liability issues. Now, that's something I want to actually. I'm going to write that down because we don't speak with liability enough. So you sent notice to the government you're going to be accessing the public roads as you have every right to do in your private property that has no liens against it because you bought it cash. You own all the equity. When you own the equity, you are king. You're sovereign of what you own the equity over. That's why I would not do a lease. It's in the lease agreement. You have to insure it through public insurance. It's right in the lease agreement. You're already violating...
Fancy long-term rental agreement.
Yeah. So you're already violating your lease the minute you try to drive around with no private property. So they don't reply. After 10 days... You want to give 10 days. I mean, 9 days is good too. What is it? 3 days for them to get it, 3 days for them to reply, and then 3 days for it to be sent back to you in a day of grace. 10 days is a pretty standard amount of time in commerce. Some people give 21, some people give 30. I don't think it's necessary. As long as you default them and send them notice of their default. Send them notice. Send it back to them. Fax it. Register it. Mail it. Go down to the legislative building and walk into the office and give them copies of everything to the staff at the front counter that are required to be there to take material from you. And say, I'd like to drop this off with the Attorney General. Could you please make a photocopy and stamp it received? Well, I've got lots of them in there where I've gone down and done that. I like to do it because just to tell people, if I'm going to tell somebody to do something, I've done it. And I've shown you guys all the paperwork. Believe me, if I'm talking about something on camera too, I've done it. So now you just put your own plate on. This is my spare. I want to be fancy. I want to be the first one of all my friends that had a color plate. They all had just none others. I wanted to get my own Irish flag color plate. So we found a place in Winnipeg that does up these little things. I think it was called... Well, never mind. I'm not going to use the name. But anyways, I'll get it up privately. So it costs almost nothing. It's metal. These are the numbers I created when I told the government I was going to be driving using this plate. When you guys see these letters, and that stands for Dean Christopher David of the Clifford family, does that have any legal effect of any kind? No. It just means that those are the numbers I gave the government to say that when you see all these numbers, you know it's me. And I've got not for hire. Well, I can't be involved in commerce. I've got private property. That's pretty plain, too. There's my fee schedule. This obviously doesn't say Manitoba on it. It's not a government plate. So it makes everything pretty clear now. So now your fee schedule. This is your notice of damages. Before they even pull you over, this is your notice, and that's why you want that. Right? So your first action after they pull you over would be to file a PPSA then the following day, followed up by a Queen's Bench lawsuit by the end of the week. As fast as possible. Bam. Same way that they do that to you guys. Except, no, I wouldn't do it by the end of the week because there's a process that I want to teach people to do with that kind of thing that's going to make it rock solid before they even walk into Queen's Bench. Because what's the rule with court? Don't go there unless... You've already won. The only time you should ever go to court. Okay, notice you'll be accessing the public roads. That one's gone. Fee schedule number plate. Just covered that one. Put anything you want in the fee schedule. I don't care. Keep the numbers. You can't find somebody $1 trillion because they just pulled you over.
That's frivolous and vexatious.
That's pretty frivolous and vexatious. But I really don't think $1 million is out of the question, to be honest with you. I mean, $1 million really isn't even a lot of money nowadays, especially by the time Obama gets done with the economy and everything else. I mean, that might buy us a loaf of bread by October. But $1 million is not unreasonable, right? People get killed in traffic stops. My life is worth at least $1 million. Every time they pull us over, they're actually endangering our lives. I take that very seriously. It's more than just the harassment.
It's true.
Right? They are endangering your life. They might approach you with guns drawn like they've done in the States because you've got your own plate on and accidentally shoot you. That happens. Right? So I've got an accidental death thing in my fee schedule too that for whatever reason, if I get killed, even though it wasn't a direct action by the police when I get pulled over, but as a result of them detaining me, it leads to my death. There's a rather nasty fee attached to that for my untimely demise that's owed to my heirs and assignees of my estate. That's all set up already. It's all done. So that's the fee schedule and the number plate. So, yeah, honestly, guys, have fun creating stuff. Make your own stuff up. We made the government. We can make anything. We can make our own new government. We make the rules. That's the end of story. So make up whatever you want. In fact, I'd like some people to send me some creative stuff they've done, just to see what other people are doing out there. I think it's great. I love reading that stuff. Who do you want to give notice to as well as the government? Well, every police force in Canada is all a member and licensed to the Police Officers Union in Ottawa. It's called CACP. I can't remember what that stands for, but there's a police chief of all the police chiefs. And I've got his name, because you can find it online right now. I can't remember. But anyways, so I faxed them a copy.
Isn't that the Canadian Association of Police Chiefs?
Chiefs of Police, I think, or something like that. Yeah, so CCAP or something like that. CACP. And they've got a police chief, and he's the chief of all the chiefs of all the police forces across Canada. Unlike the RCMP, that's different. So we all know the RCMP has a head office in Ottawa as well. I think that's still, I'm not going to say the name either, I know who it is. Send him notice and address it right to him. He's the head honcho. You're the head honcho of your organization, aren't you? Well, I only deal with other head honchos, right? I'm not going to walk into the RCMP station in Selkirk and give it to the lady at the front counter and say, here you go, and expect that when I walk in, I'll drive out to BC, that they're going to have notice out there. I mean, okay, notice to agent, notice to principal, but let's be realistic here. It's better to always send to the top guy. And that also lets them know you're not really afraid of them, too. I kind of like that, too. You're like, hey, you know, I'm right here. You know, come and get me. Here's my fee schedule. What are you going to do? So we'll send it to them. CCAP, RCMP, now they've got notice. You may want to send one to the Governor General for, not the Governor General, sorry, the Attorney General for Canada, and maybe to the Attorney Generals of the provinces across Canada. That's going out of the way. I don't think you really have to do that, but be my guest. You know, there's no such thing as giving too much notice.
Especially if you travel a lot.
Or if you don't travel a lot, but you find you're going to be going to Alberta or Saskatchewan sometime in the near future, oh, well, I'm going to go out there. You know what? I think it's just polite if I give everybody notice out there I'm coming. And I've got a fee schedule. I've got my own plate. I'm just going to be, you know, nice and do my due diligence. So, because there is some responsibility on here as well to let other vessels out there and other organizations know you're going to be out and about in the commercial world and doing your thing. Anything else anybody can think of? Great, drop me a line. Let me know what you did. I'd love to hear. I think that wraps that up, though, really. Like, there's no one else to really give notice to. Before you do this, you may want to read and understand Queen's Bench Rules and Procedure. You don't want to make a threat you can't follow up on. I've done it. And then you go, shit. Now I got to learn that real quick. Because I just threatened to do that, and I got no freaking clue how to do that. So just know it all in advance. It's a big deal. You got to drive with a plate and license for another 2-3 months. You've been doing it for, what, 15 years already? You know, don't speed. Ooh, it's not hard. You don't have to do some, you know, this stuff overnight. So get accustomed to Queen's Bench Rules and Procedures. So you need to have an idea of how to start a claim in Queen's Bench once you now have a claim to take there. And then at the side of the road, you can say, you know, hey, public servant, just so you're aware, I'm going to be swearing out affidavits of everything that happened, and I'm going to be filing a claim against you in Queen's Bench. That'll have an impact. You know, at that point, it's up to them. You know, you can choose to proceed with whatever you're doing. Everything that now happens is your choice. And you're free to make any choice you want in life. But you're not going to escape the liability of your actions. And I'll see that. It's a really nice, polite way of saying that. But it sounds kind of good, too. They probably won't like to hear that a whole lot. So, aside, that's all I really got written down, actually. Because aside from that, it just actually comes down to your handling of the situation once you're actually pulled over by a cop or check stop, wherever you are. And now that we know the Highway Traffic Act only applies to somebody performing a function of government, as per their own rules and regulations, it makes sense. I only have jurisdiction over anything performing business as me. It's no different for them, because we know the Canadian government's not a government. They're actually a foreign corporation. We've extended a privilege to them of being here operating on our soil. So, when I find a way to revoke that privilege, I'll let you guys
say
know. Well, all these corporations do business here, right? Walmart's got stores here. Coke's got stores. We have stores here. They don't have jurisdiction over you anymore, and the government does. But if you went and got a Walmart card and went shopping in Walmart, well, Walmart's probably got some say over the policies of how you use that card and what you do when you're in their store, right? It's no different. You just got to keep thinking that that's actually what's going on. So when you get pulled over, you know, don't get me wrong, it's not like police don't have any jurisdiction over you. If you've actually harmed somebody and they've got a lawful warrant, or you've been breaching the peace, yeah, no amount of talking is going to get you out of that if you're going to jail. And that's why I keep saying every time when we get together, and we'll keep doing it for the camera, nothing that is being taught online is going to get you out of a charge where you've harmed somebody. And that's where the whole honor system comes down. You've got to conduct yourselves honorably in society, right? So,
or do no harm.
Because once there really is an injured party coming against you, you will be held accountable. So when a cop pulls you over, think of new things to say to these people. The possibilities are endless, but one you want to get out of the way real quick is, public servant, peace officer, I don't care if you want to call me. Did you observe me breach the peace? Right? Well, no, license registration. Well, hang on, no. So you didn't observe me breach the peace. Okay, well, are you claiming that I'm a public servant? Well, that's a very dicey one for them now. Now you're starting to narrow it down. Now you haven't breached the peace. And as soon as they answer that question, well, they got to prove their claim if they're claiming you're a public servant, right? That's why they really want you to produce that ID. They need you to testify against yourself. And they're usually going to say no, because probably most of them don't even know what that means. But after they say that, you have a little argument. You say, well, I'm sorry, I don't have ID because I'm not an agent of the government. They're probably going to go back to their car and they're going to call the Crown. Because they're writing everything down, they're recording everything, they're going to call and they're going to say, well, I told him, this guy asked me if I thought he's a public servant. I said no, and then he said he doesn't have government ID because he's not an agent of the government. Well, he's going to get some very special instructions probably on how to proceed very carefully now not to harm your human rights. And then just go from there and just kind of wing it. But don't ever make statements or testify against yourself or anything. Right? You want to keep it short, sweet, to the point. Say, am I under arrest? Right? That's another thing. I wanted to use that one. I've never used it yet. It's basically when they come up to the window and you say, well, peace officer, am I under arrest? And they'll be like, no. You know, license registration. It's like, well, I'm not under arrest. I'm free to go. No, you're not. Oh, so I'm under arrest. No. Oh, then I'm free to go. Well, and just back and forth. Arrest me or let me go. But it's only one of the two. The reason they won't arrest you is they can't. They've got no jurisdiction yet. They don't want you to go because they're not finished intimidating you to try to get you to testify against yourself. See, you're your own worst enemy. You're going to do it all to yourself. So that's the greatest part about it is no one's really harming you but yourself when you're out there. And just get educated. And once your mind is the weapon you need when you get pulled over, it's going to be a lot more fun. And start proving damages, too. Like when they get pulled over, say, just so you're aware, hand them a copy of the fee schedule. But just so you're aware, here's a certified copy of the fee schedule in place between myself and the province. I'm not danger to the government. You're damaging me, right? You got to give notice of damages. You're damaging me right now as we speak, and this is what the damages are. And then I told you guys a story just like a week and a half ago with my brother there that they claimed to have a warrant for him for assault for politely removing somebody from his property. It was trespassing. And he refused to go speak to the RCMP and testify against himself. And said, no, if you got a charge, come out and bring it to me. If you got a warrant, come out and give me the warrant. Whatever you guys got, you can fax it to me, you can send it to me. They refused. They wouldn't send him anything. So they ended up pulling him over at a routine traffic stop where they pulled his license plate number and got his name and decided to pull him over and put the gloves on and, oh yeah, this is going to be fun. We want this guy. And just from simple questions like that, like, are you claiming I'm a public servant? Like, no. And they're like, well, we have a warrant for your arrest. He goes, well, good. Where's the warrant? Well, obviously, we don't have it here. Well, that sounds like a you problem and not a me problem. Right? Like, I gave you guys ample opportunity to provide me with a warrant. This isn't the time or the place to be doing it at the side of the road. Kind of thing. They're like, well, get out of the truck. We want to speak to you, kind of thing, right? And he said, well, no, thank you. You have no jurisdiction over me. If you want me to get out of the truck, I'm sorry, I don't work for free. Is the guy going to produce a labor contract on the spot where you agreed to do what a cop says at the side of the road for $4 an hour? No. Okay. Well, if you want me to get out, that's going to cost you. That's what he told me. He says, well, if you want me to get out of my truck and stand there, it's going to cost you $50,000. And the cop says, okay, yeah, whatever, whatever. Says, okay, whatever. He gets out, he scans right there, and he says, okay, that's going to be $50,000. Now what do you want? I need you in the back of that car while I write up this, while I print up this friggin' promise to appear, write up a promise to appear. He's like, no, I didn't agree to get out of the truck and stand right here. If you want me in the back of your car, it's going to cost $1 million. $1 million. And the cop's like, if you don't get in the back of my car, I'm going to arrest you and throw you in there. And he goes, well, you can do that. Because you don't have my consent. It's still going to cost you $1 million. So, oh, fuck him, just stay there then. He walks away, you know? I'm on the phone, I'm listening to this, and I'm kind of coaching him on what to say a little bit. So, like I said, it's first-hand knowledge. And I'm like, I'm kind of laughing. I'm like, oh man, he might really get arrested here. This is great. So, but no, he came back with the promise to appear, and made him sign it, and that's when he signed in his own way, you know, letting him know he's not a public servant, which the cop already admitted to. And it's going to happen. You're going to get pulled over if you try to grab another plate. So hopefully you've been to court a couple of times, and you've gotten over the fear of a cop who's going to threaten to arrest you if you don't comply with his orders, when you're not obligated to obey his orders. You're obligated to obey court orders, not his.
Maybe talk a bit about conditional acceptance. When they're threatening you at some point.
You know what? I understand. The conditional acceptance is correct. But people want to get too drawn out into the conversation. You know, like that's some of the creditors and commerce kind of stuff, right? With, well, I conditionally accept your offer on the condition that you accept my offer, that you accept the condition that, you know, you go on about 8 sentences longer. And none of you know what the hell either one's talking about now. That's just confusing, right? What you could do is just, again, keep it simple. Keep it very simple. If you want to do conditional acceptance, say, I conditionally accept your offer. Well, on the condition you can prove that there's a contract between our two parties.
Well, just go back to your story right there with your brother there, when he said, like, get out of the car. I was like, okay, I'll stand right here, but it'll cost you
That is conditional acceptance. That's me, without actually saying it, that is conditional acceptance. I will get out of the truck, but it's going to cost you $50,000. Do you agree to that? That is conditional acceptance without actually saying it, right? If you want me to do that, I don't work for free, because I'm pretty sure they got rid of involuntary servitude a couple of decades ago. At least last week.
Yeah.
They for sure got rid of slavery like maybe a week ago. So, involuntary servitude, against the law, you can't force me to do anything for free. You can force me to do something, but it's not going to be free, dude. It's going to cost you $1 million if you're going to force me in the back of your car. Do you accept that? Now you're the one asking them if they accept. Do you accept my offer that is going to cost you $1 million, whether I get in the back of your car voluntarily or whether you force me to? Because if I wind up in the back of your car, it doesn't matter how it happened, it's going to be $1 million. That's conditional acceptance. That's the proper way to do that. That's why I don't like the, you know, I conditionally accept your offer on the condition that you did, you know, da, 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 da. You just sound like a dancing monkey out there, and the guy's just going to be, what the hell are you talking about? You know, as he's reaching, putting his gloves on and reaching for the pepper spray. Right? So that's notice. Hey, I'll get out of my truck, not a problem. But I'm not doing it for free. How much is your bond worth? Say that. You know, you feel lucky today? What's your bond worth? Don't say that, obviously, when you can't decide who goes. But don't say anything. Don't say anything you want.
I really do.
It just sounds good. Yeah, you know, sometimes things like that are just fun to say. Okay. So other than that, when all that fails and you wind up in jail, then we fall back on our courtroom tactics, which we haven't really covered yet. We're going to have a special, actual, scheduled courtroom tactics and what to say and when, and the three times I stumbled on it and then didn't even realize what I had done when they brought me before a magistrate, and I didn't realize what was going on, and all I did was I said to the magistrate, you know, like, I refused to give my name after 3 days in jail or something like that, and they brought me before a magistrate. This is when I'm about 28. And the cops were doing this, well, we think he's this guy, and blah, 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 blah. They're doing their, you know, their trained monkey stuff, and then they give their whole spiel, and this guy was doing this in contravention of the Highway Traffic Act and yada yada, and they stop, and the magistrate says, okay, well, whoever you are, what's your name? And the first thing I said is, well, I said, I'm sorry, again, there's been no charge for me to answer to. I'm not going to testify against myself until there's a charge for me to answer to. Well, they can't even charge you without a name, obviously. Right? If there was an injured party, they could charge me no matter what. Guy that we arrested punched this other dude in the face, right? Okay, well, they have no name to take the summary convictions, and that's actually in a... I've got a Supreme Law case about that, Supreme Court of Canada law lawsuit, where the police can't even arrest you if they don't have a name to take the summary convictions court. And that's the name on the driver's license. That's why they need that so badly. Any form of ID, government ID, because they can only take government agents to summary convictions court. All kind of makes sense, doesn't it? So anyways, and then right after I said that to the magistrate, and I said, besides, I don't even know who you are. There's a voice on the phone, you know. People who hear voices go to the loony bin. So I don't know who you are. So this guy could have called his grandmother. I didn't say that, but that's what I'm thinking. Like, really, this guy could have called his grandmother just to get me to spill my guts on the phone. Shouldn't I need some verification who I'm speaking to? So I said, excuse me, are you a public servant? Well, there's just silence, and there's like, no, I'm not. Well, yes, I am, but I'm not. Well, yeah. I'll be right back. And there's just silence for a couple of minutes on the phone. And the cops are looking at me, and they're going like, oh, you're in really big trouble now. So I was like, oh, thanks, yeah. That's... Okay, anyways. And when they came back, the magistrate, first thing, you know, whoever you have there, you get him to the Selkirk Courthouse now. Well, I was out the door, in the car, to the Selkirk Courthouse, and brought into a courtroom where they already had a trial ready. Like, there's a judge, there's already a crown, there's paperwork scrambling all over the place. I've been in jail for 28 hours now. They have no name to take summary convictions court. And I just told that lady on the phone, who I don't know who she is, that my human rights have been violated. I haven't harmed anybody, and I'm not going to give her my name because there's no charge against me. I'm being held without charge, and we're now on hour 28. Well, you better believe they had court in session by the time I got there. But then, as soon as I got there, I went back to some of the same stupid friggin' arguments. The first words out of my mouth to the justice should have been, excuse me, are you a public servant? Who are you people?
Who are you, my objector?
Yeah, but I did. I went right back. I just said, well, I'm not giving you my name because there's been no charge, you know, blah, 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 this and that, and which is correct. They couldn't do anything. They did throw me in jail for another 3 days, but that was a really bad idea on their part. But that's all they could really do is try to hold you for what they claim is 72 hours and rolls over into 90-something. If you got a fee schedule in place, it's all damages. You don't care. But be prepared to go to jail for at least a couple of days. If you're not prepared to go to jail for a couple of days, keep your license, pay your taxes, give tribute to Caesar, and enjoy. Keep your head down and don't bitch about a thing the government does. So, period. So, who are they charging in court? Well, every police complaint I've ever read, even when I went down to the RCMP and initiated an investigation into their conduct with me, when they took the information and they went to write down my name, I spelled it out for the guy. I gave him my affidavit and I said, that's my name. He goes, oh, okay, so... And this is where... I always wondered, a little story on this, I always wondered whether cops know. I always wondered that. These bastards know. You know, because I'd be a lot more personally offended if they really did, as opposed to it being just bad, poor training. Or a combination of both, which is most likely true.
Well, it depends on how long they've been up, how high they've been up, all that stuff.
All that stuff. So I went down and I got this, Royal Canadian Mounted Policeman, I want to make a complaint or whatever. Just I knew that it was going to go nowhere. I just like to see what happens when they actually going to do this. So I gave him my affidavit and I said, this is my name. This is what you can call me when you refer to me. Whatever you want to say to somebody, that's my name. Okay, so he starts filling out the complaint. I grabbed a piece of it, I said, no. I actually took the pen and scribbled it out. And I wrote it properly. I said, that's not what I told you. You just converted my name to something that's not me.
Spelt it wrong.
And he wouldn't even look up. He goes, I can't write it that way. He wouldn't look at me. I said, what do you mean you can't write it that way? He goes, for our records, I can't write it that way. I said, I don't give a shit about your records. That's not my name. He's like, I can't write it that way. I'm like, right, whatever. I said, write it whatever you way want, and I don't give a shit. So he scratched out where I corrected it, and he went back to writing my name like that. Why is that? Well, that's the public servant they're taking to court. That's who the complaint is made against. So they're having a hearing in court for this guy, my legal person. The complaint has been made against that guy, and we're giving the paperwork to that guy. So now we have three different identities. We haven't touched on this before. We've spoken about how public servants are all they take to public servant court, which is summary convictions, right? Where they're having a hearing for this guy, they're getting you to show up. But what they don't want you to know is that you're actually representing this guy. That's who the complaint by a police officer had been made against. They can only deal with public servants. Their only real authority is over public servants, even if it's an actual charge. If I actually had a real bona fide claim against somebody, I would take them to Queen's Bench, which can hear criminal and civil. Right? But if I don't know my rights, and I've been duped all my life into thinking that every time there's a problem, I gotta call the cops, right? Which is a police service. They're not providing us with a service. They're like, when they advertise, it's like any other corporation that wants your business, and they want your business. Why? Just like an insurance company, when you contract with the police and make your statement and sign it, you're contracting with them, and you're subrogating your rights to them. If you have them charge somebody and take them to court and that person goes to jail, do you get any money out of that? No. You don't get any remedy. Why is that?
You
subrogated it to them. They're collecting on the damages. Believe me, they are. They're getting paid, and they're getting paid well. They're getting paid what you should be getting for damages because you decided to use a service to enforce your rights instead of doing it yourself. Right? They're collecting on all the jail bonds and the court bonds, everything else that's being produced, all the securities. They're collecting on it all, them and the Crown. And they're all in cahoots to do it too. So anyways, that's the guy. That's the public servant. Three identities, Holy Trinity, holy shit. If somebody can find me a complaint in their court file where the name is spelled any other way than that, I'd love to see it. Because it doesn't exist. That's the public servant identity that they don't want you to know about. So you go to court and they're having a hearing for your legal person that you are the beneficiary and grantor of, that you're also the director of, and that you're also the public servant of now. You're all three. Who are you going to court against when you go to court?
Yourself.
You're your own worst enemy. We can touch on that another day. Absolutely. Yeah, the hearing's for your legal person. It's against you in a different capacity. Who else could you be going to court against? Because there's no injured party except for your legal person, I guess, technically speaking. They're claiming a public servant injured your legal person. The problem was the public servant was you.
You have a contract to protect yourself.
So that's how they steal from your estate. Who gets the damages? Do you get a check in the mail with the name of your legal person on it? No. So who gets that?
They don't.
Them. Good little theft gimmick going on.
Yeah.
Anyways, I'll wait for the red dots to be coming through my windows whatever night this gets put on the internet, but so whatever.
He's living with it.
Yeah, like I said, I don't care. We were all created energy when I dialed back to being that, whatever. I don't care. I'll check. Okay. That's why people need to watch movies like Braveheart, you know? I won't do the speech. I'd rather fight now. Yeah. Because I would be like that. I'd be one of those old bastards dying in his bed going, son of a bitch, I should have done it when I was younger. You know? So, okay. Okay. So we're done talking about that. We can elaborate. People who watch the videos online, if you've got questions about that, honestly, send them in. Turns out we do read them. And I will reply to something, especially once we start getting into more specialized classes. Liability issues. Okay, everyone's scared to death of liability. We talked about it earlier. It's impossible for an insurance company or anyone else to assume liability for your actions. That's why insurance is a scam. It's a con job from the get-go. No one can ever assume liability for your actions. If you kill somebody on the highways, does the insurance company go, oh, no, no, what's that murder charge worth? Oh, no, here you go. Oh, no, it's paid. No, you're not going to jail. It's okay. No, you're held liable for your actions. It's a scam, right? And what it also is, it makes people not responsible for their actions, especially when people think they're covered by insurance. So this is kind of where we're getting out of like any actual statutory law, getting into like free man theories, well, free man society kind of stuff, or whatever you guys want to call it, free man. what people have to understand, this is why I get into the whole honor system. The word freedom and responsibility are the same word. They're synonymous terms. You cannot be free without responsibility attached to it. And the simple proof for that is, would a zoo be liable if they had people come into a zoo and they had live tigers running around everywhere and one of the tigers ate your kid? Would the zoo be liable for that? Probably. So where are the tigers? They're in cages. Okay? So if the zoo is not responsible, or they limit their liability, well, no, we took precautions. We made sure that they were, you know, locked up and stuff like that, okay? Of course, animals aren't responsible for their actions anyways. But if you don't want to be responsible for anything that you do, then you're going to be in a cage to limit the damage you can do to society. And rightfully so. I don't want some axe-wielding maniac out there running around, you know, burying his hatchet in people's heads because he's not responsible for his actions, saying, I'm a free man, I can do whatever I want. Well, no, you can't. You just harm somebody. You just cut somebody's head off on a Greyhound bus. And you got out 2 years later. So anyways, that's my dig at that. Yeah, exactly.
Just for the record, that guy did not live in Greyhound status.
Yeah. So...
He was not a member.
Yeah. No responsibility, no freedom. If you don't want to be responsible for anything you're doing, then you shouldn't be free. If you want to take all responsibility, which you're going to, you're going to be liable for everything you do when you're out operating in society, then that's inherent freedom. You have the freedom to do what you want because nobody's assuming liability for your actions. Right? So we're actually the most responsible people on the roads when we drive with our own plates and without a driver's license. We have to be the most responsible people because we don't have the delusion that an insurance company is going to cover anything that we do. We're responsible for our actions, right? And then this is where it gets into driving again. Now a lot of people always say, "Well, if you hurt somebody or destroy their car, how are you going to pay for that?" You know, that's why you guys can't do what you do. It's like, well, okay, number one, they're the public roads. When you leave your house in the morning and do anything in society, you are assuming the risk that you might actually get damaged. A car might just careen out of nowhere and just kill you. Does that mean you're owed money? No, like, shit happens. Sorry, deal with it, right? If you want to be protected every minute of your life from the time you're born till the time you die, then go live in a bubble somewhere, in a basement, and don't ever leave. But as soon as you do leave and you leave your home, it's with the understanding that everybody else that's out there has assumed the risk that they might get injured while they're out there. Right? That's just life. Deal with it. But that's how government gets control over us. They want us to be afraid. Oh, do you want to be out there and have someone just...
money? That's crazy!
No, it's life. That's
I'd much rather have you not hit me in the first place.
Exactly! But you know, there's a risk that might happen. Does that person damage you? Yes. Should they go to jail? Yes. Did they kill you? Okay, well then I guess they owe your family money, whatever, right? The guy goes to jail. Then paying his due to society, a debt to society, whatever, like, yeah, there's reimbursements for that. But for the most part, people don't ever think. The first thing people think, this is the whole problem with society. People's first response is me. What happens to me if I get injured? Never once has somebody asked me, well, what happens if you write off your car? That just tells me no one cares about anybody else. They just care about me. I only care about me. I want to know what's going to happen if you damage me. I want to know how much money I'm getting, right? That's the problem. Well, how about let's flip this around and say, well, no, I'm actually taking responsibility for my actions to the point where if I just drive into a tree and destroy what I just worked really hard to pay for, I'm not getting anything. I got to go work to buy another car. How many people would drive like morons on the road?
Not too many.
Not too many. Maybe the absurdly rich, I don't know. You know? Oh, well, I rode off another bike last week, you know? But that's not a valid argument for the rest of us to have insurance and stuff like that. Nothing is. So assuming liability for your actions, we are the most responsible people in the world because we are taking responsibility for what we do. If we damage somebody else's car, well, I guess we're paying for it. And thankfully, because of the fiat money system that we got going right now, we're paying, you know, there's no such thing as money anyway, as a promise to pay is payment. Do you really care? If you damage somebody, okay, send me a bill. Thank you.
But that's part of, like, your license plate is meant to have a bond attached to it so that if you are in an accident, you can actually attach it to the bond and pay to anybody who needs it, right?
Okay, so if...
Like, if you cause the accident...
Okay, so now if insurance companies are licensed by the government...
Yeah. Oh, no, I'm talking about, like, your personal ones that you made.
Yeah, oh, yeah, I was going to say, because that's what because
when you're
what possible bonding could somebody else provide for me that I can't provide for myself?
Exactly.
I can bond myself.
So you can still make the argument that the point isn't that you're just going to smash into people, yeah. And it's like, oh, well, that was
how... We've got people to do that, actually. There are people that generate, like, you know, $10 billion bonds or whatever, unlimited liability bonds, unlimited. Because you got to remember... Government is limited. We are unlimited. In Texas Hold'em, we win every time. We have more liability than them. So we can just issue them an unlimited liability bond to say, access this bond if I cause damages. But only if I cause damages. That's a whole other branch of stuff that I don't really talk about or get onto too much. But if you file a bond in the public with the government and that bond's accessible if you cause damages, then all somebody has to do is bring their claim and leverage it against the bond. So, I don't know. Any questions on that? That's kind of getting into more obscure type stuff, but just don't drive like an idiot. I guess I'll be responsible. You won't have to worry about it. The best part is, though, if a government vehicle, a vehicle with a government license plate on it, hits you, then they're going to be settling very quickly. There's going to be no auto pack, you know, like we're all covered by the same insurance company, you can't sue anybody kind of stuff. That's not going to happen. And also, if you do damage somebody and they do sue you and they take you to court, that's great. Because anybody that watches Winston Strawman videos would know what to do with the court order. Immediately. And then it's paid. Perfect, take me to court. In fact, let's not even go to court. I'll just confess to it right now. You get the court order. There's no need for a trial. Yep, I did the damages, not a problem, I assume all liability for my actions. Take my confession down to the, let's just not even have a trial, let's just go straight to the court order, and then I'll take care of it. There's some inherent problems with that as well, that's just getting right back into, well, I don't care if I cause damages now, because I can just, you know, write stuff off, but I don't believe that. I think you're still going to find that you're going to have a lot of problems when you go to do that, so...
I was going to say it doesn't sound right.
It's not that, yeah. A lot of people think it is, but...
You two governments with you when you do it.
Yeah, if you're... Then what you're doing is if you're getting right back into the game of getting government to assume your liabilities by having them, monetize your obligations or whatever you want to call that happening, and then you're right back into, you know, you're claiming you want to live without government interference, but then you're running right to them to discharge your debts the minute you run into your first problem.
Yeah, you're using their fraudulent methods.
Exactly. So I don't like that. I don't. There could be some nasty consequences to that. I don't know. I don't think anybody's ever been there. I don't want to find out.
No, you
So, any questions about that? No? Okay, that's tonight's lesson. I guess we'll probably talk off camera again for a little bit, but we'll leave it at that for whatever's going on online.
So you're going to do a blind on it.